still defending the south end now.
Square
there
seven.
There he goes, a long one. Sellers caught it. He's kicked back and fine touch just about the halfway line. Wales' ball.
Come on.
And Harding throwing it in, a fairly long one. England have it. I think it's Tucker. It's down on the ground. England have heeled. Out to Wharton. Now to Laird. Corbett. Oh. Lock. Out to Gibbs. Gibbs is going down the line. He's got past Andrews and he's up to the 25. He kicked across. The English back are up. The Turnbull's there. Oh, well done, sir.
It's a puzzle of the calendar that Britain's first ever live running commentary on sport was on BBC Radio in 1927. On Saturday afternoon, the 15th of January, several months before Talking Pictures arrived, Square One was born at Twickenham, when an ex-soldier and harlequin, Teddy Wakelam, described the international rugby match when England beat Wales by 11 points to 9. Now, in the commentary box with Wakelam was a blind man who'd previously been sighted, and so he was able to visualise the game and check if the commentator painted a true picture. The third person was an actor, Charles Lapworth, whose voice called out, square one, square three, pinpointing on a grid map of the field that listeners had in front of them where the play actually was. Radio listeners were suddenly asked to cast themselves on a sea of imagination. So in the beginning was the word, and the word still rules. Maybe in that ramshackle commentary hut, the speakers were at first tentative, but it marked the dawn of something new, and in the past 60 years or so, voices have echoed the spirit of rugby in many different ways. This is uniquely Spike Milligan.
That's beautiful. It's great. I don't know anything else more. The marvel of waiting to see the next game. For a whole week before, I'm beautifully excited at the prospect of watching this game all the time. It's like a constant painting being added to all the time, this lovely picture. Marvellous game, isn't it? Rugby, God almighty. I think I'd have died earlier if it hadn't been for rugby.
A game that, at its best, breaks down barriers.
Everybody starts level inside a jersey, whether he's a king or a commoner, whatever he is. Once he's got a jersey on, he's got to get on with the rest. And I've played with miners in Wales and all sorts of people and chaps at Oxford who are blue-blooded and so on and so forth. But once they've got a jersey on, they've got to look after themselves. And if they can't, they're out of it. And they've got to be able to mix in. I think this is a great thing about rugby. It brings all sorts of people together.
The voice of Vivian Jenkins, great international player, rugby writer and philosopher. And here's one of England's most adventurous back-row forwards, Peter Robbins, for whom the game was also about fun.
But it seems to me that the nation, and they've been pilloried in recent years, that provide most humour, the Irish. There's a great story of a wing forward who tackled a fly half, not late but posthumously, and the referee blew up for a penalty, and he said, what is that for, referee? He said, late tackle. He said, I got here as soon as I could.
J.E. Greenwood played for England before and after the First World War.
You had to buy your own shirt. They never bought one for you, and they provided the rows which you sewed on yourself. You had to find your own way everywhere, and you carried your bag from Twickenham Station. No coach, no lunch. You never saw each other before the match.
And there's the action, sheer and stark, which fires the imagination.
And out it comes, and Cliff Morgan gets it. He gets it out to Williams, bled him. He kicks a little one ahead, and it's been beautifully picked up. And here goes Rowland scraping down, and he's going to score. Rowland's has scored a try for Cardiff. Rowland's has scored a try for Cardiff in the corner. I wish you could see the side as I'm seeing it here now. Oh, don't worry about lucky bounces. It's all in the game. It was a lovely try.
Vintage 1953. And the vintage voice of Winston McCarthy of New Zealand. The perfect commentary sound and a technique that set the standards. Now, this rugby collection is not strictly a study of the history of rugby on the wireless, or for that matter, of the game itself. It's simply a personal selection of sounds that mark achievements, action, delights and laughter, stories and memories like these from Tony O'Reilly of Ireland and the world.
But I'd like to forget the first couple of times I played internationals. I was only 18 at the time, and the first two or three didn't go very well. But the first really successful international was in Wales in 1955. In March, it was a prelude to that Lions tour we went on together. I went out and we stood to attention for Land of Our Fathers.
Quite right.
Rigidly, if I say so. And we, in my case, would freight. And I looked across, I'd ascertained that my opponent was Alan Thomas, I gather, president of the Rugby Football Union in Wales. Mm. And he was officially 5'8" and weighed 11 stone 6 pounds. I was officially 6'3" and weighed 14 stone 5. At the end of Land of Our Fathers, I was 2'6" and weighed about 3 stone, and he was 9'6" and weighed 15 stone. It was a terrifying experience. So it was a game of some gaiety. You scored a very fine try that day.
Thank you very much.
We were narrowly defeated, 21-0, and as Tom Reed said afterwards, Jez, weren't we lucky to get nil.
Absolutely right. Well, you must have been a baby when I played here first, weren't you? You were in school, were you? 1952, you see, because...
Oh, yes, I was waiting outside the ground for your autograph.
No, but it's funny, because do you know my vivid memory of that, Roy Copp, is that my father lost his teeth during the match between Ireland and Wales at Lansdowne Road. I mean, I tell you what happened, because when we did a scissors movement, Ken Jones and I in the halfway line, and my father was in the back row but one of the grandstand. That's the tickets we got in those days. Only one ticket each. And suddenly, my father jumped and shouted when we did the scissors movement, see? And his top set went 15 rows in front. And he never, ever got them back.
No, the Irish are like that. They're quite larcenous about teeth. I'd say they've probably been worn by a man down in Galway now.
Yes, sure it was.
But actually, that particular movement, I do recall, Ken Jones, ran 70 yards, straight as a die, to score under the post, pursued all the way by George Phipps,
yes.
A very quick Irishman, who was promptly dropped by the Irish team for showing unacceptable speed.
Yes.
And never played for Ireland again.
That's typical of selectors, isn't it, you know? Couldn't pick their noses. Used to be the winning Wales. Yeah. I tell you, it's interesting. See, people always hit you. What does the atmosphere like in the dressing room, Mr. Morgan? And atmosphere in dressing rooms are very important, it seems to me. Because the Welsh always were passionate. Like a Welsh preacher used to say, and we will get them, pull them down, and then spring the surprise. It was the great phrase, I remember that. Yeah.
The figures I remember in Irish dressing rooms were Jack Kyle, the legendary Olympian Jack Kyle, perhaps your greatest adversary. Mm. Kyle, in one game in Wales, despite 60,000 songsters outside singing Land of Our Fathers, was fast asleep in the dressing room and actually managed to miss the team photograph. Now, that's an absolute first. The other was Cecil Pedlow, one of his great comments early in our career, was as his head came through an Irish jersey, he said, you know, O'Reilly, and this was before the game, you know, O'Reilly, he said, this is the 11th successive defeat we've shared together.
I must say, Tony, you know, because you look at a player, you say, I envy him. And I envied young Jonathan Davies, the Welsh fly half. He's got everything, the shape, the movement. And like the soldier in Wilfred Owen's great poem, you know, he had both mastery and mystery.
Cliffy Bach, the thing he hasn't got, though, are the wounds. He's got to earn the wounds. And they take long years of attrition. Mind you earn them more quickly in Wales, where you play 64 games a season. But I always remember you coming back off the tour, putting your arm on my shoulder and saying to me, Tony, remember, next year it's going to be different. To be as good as you were, you've got to be twice as good as you were, because the gaps get smaller when your name gets bigger. The real test of Davies will be when he establishes himself as a major force in football. Then the bruises will take longer to heal, the gaps will be smaller, and the offences much more organized against him. That'll be the test of his greatness.
Jonathan Davies did prove his greatness at Union and then at Rugby League. Tony was talking about the bumps and the bruises that inevitably come in a game of bodily contact, a topic close to the heart of that most remarkable player, Gareth Edwards.
You do take a bit of a buffeting, but then one plays the game, takes up the position initially in life, knowing that you're going to be susceptible to this type of thing. As you get more experience, you're able to use your ability and your knowledge to get into positions either to tackle, to be effective, to stop them coming through, or to be more candid, to get out of the way a bit quickly. I'll never forget the Barbarians game in 1967 when Colin Mees came through the line-out, and his whole objective at that particular moment was to run straight at Barry and squash him into the ground. Somehow or other, as I turned, I just managed to grab one of Colin's ankles and ankle tap him. and he fell like the big pine tree he is, within possibly 2 centimetres of Barry, who was absolutely white by that time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.